So today let's take a look at the progress in the development of my metal detector. I am still testing it using this small aluminium coin. And it's just starting to detect it from about 35 centimeters. I added more turns on the receiver coil and I used a thicker wire for the transmitter coil. Now the transmitter coil is 30 turns of a 0.7 mm diameter copper wire. It's again wound around this CD box and so it was on about 125 mm diameter and then it was distorted into this shape. It's about 240 microhenry. There is about 9 volts of high frequency AC sine wave voltage on it. And the new feedback transformer has two primaries, 32 turns each, using half a millimeter diameter wire, and 16 turns for the feedback winding, 0.3 millimeters. I reduced the resistance of those resistors just to be sure it's not going to desaturate. And the entire 64 turn primary has 0.82 mHg or 820 microhenry inductance. It runs at about 11 to 12 kHz and the resonant capacitor is 1 microfarad. And here's the configuration of the new transformer, the dimensions of the center column, the height of the core, the air gap, and the dimensions of the window in it. And I found out that this resonant capacitor is quite important for the power consumption, for the efficiency. The consumption depends on the type of capacitor you use. And it's still the same capacitance, but it may draw different power based on the losses in the capacitor. Because of course this capacitor is resonating a lot of power with the coil. The coil has about 9 volts and the current through the coil is a bit over half an amp, so it's resonating about 5 volt amps. But from the power supply it draws about 70 or 80 milliamps now, just about 0.4 watts. So it's less than 10% of real power and the rest of it is just reactive power resonating in it. And by using a better capacitor I reduced the power consumption of the transmitter by about 40%. And the capacitors have the same capacitance, it's just purely the difference in the dissipation factor of the capacitor. I initially used a capacitor from some capacitive dropper from some cheap Chinese LED. It was getting warm and the consumption was higher. And by using a proper capacitor, some high frequency pulsed operation capacitor from some powerful computer power supply, suddenly the capacitor runs completely cold and it draws less power. But of course the output voltage is still the same or even a little bit higher. Some capacitors basically have more losses. The cheap ones are probably polyester or something. The proper pulsed operation ones are polypropylene. So that's the transmitter, which is basically just a zero voltage switching oscillator. And here's the receiver section, which of course for some microcontroller digital enthusiasts might look like an absolute analog nightmare, but let's take a look at it and explain it. Here's the receiver coil with the resonant capacitor, and this resonant capacitor boosts the voltage almost 10 times on it, and it also gives it a selectivity. It selectively receives just the frequency of the transmitter. And of course this capacitor is selected such a way that the resonant frequency of the receiver circuit is the same as the resonant frequency of the transmitter circuit. And there are some protective diodes, two in anti-parallel, limiting the voltage to about half a volt, their voltage drop in forward. And here's the coupling capacitor and the first amplifier transistor, and this one amplifies the high frequency from the coil. There is some collector resistor and this base resistor. And of course the ratio of those resistors is chosen such a way that on the collector the transistor has about half of the input voltage. So the voltage basically has enough headroom to swing into both directions. So there is about 2.5 volts, or maybe 2 volts, because you're actually interested in just the positive half cycle anyway. So it might make sense to give it more headroom in the positive side rather than in the negative side. So it has enough headroom to swing into the positive, and then there is this demodulation transistor. And the previous version had just a diode for the demodulation, rectifying the positive half cycle of the high frequency AC voltage here. And it basically turns the high frequency into this envelope, the red line. But somebody in the comments suggested I should use an emitter follower for the demodulation. So I put a transistor here instead of the diode, and this demodulates the signal without loading this amplifier too much. And it basically charges this capacitor to the peak level of this signal minus about half a volt voltage drop of this base to emitter junction. And it actually takes most of the current from the power supply, not from this amplifier. And here's the demodulation capacitor, which smooths out the demodulated voltage, and its discharging resistor, and it's also kind of a low-pass filter. There is still, of course, some high-frequency ripple on the capacitor, but not too much. And then the next stages are low-frequency amplifiers, amplifying basically just the slow changes of the voltage on this capacitor. And the bandwidth of it is just something like from 1/4 of a hertz to about 5 hertz, 10 hertz. Basically the frequencies you can generate by a mechanical motion, by physically moving the coil. And this capacitor basically works as a low pass filter and this one as a high pass filter. Then there is this first stage of the amplifier and it's coupled into the next stage, which is an amplifier but also an active band pass filter. It has a negative feedback via this capacitor, so it doesn't pass frequencies above a certain threshold. And of course this is to get rid of the interferences and also to get rid of the remains of the high frequency signal that came through this. And then it goes into the next stage with this transistor and a potentiometer to basically set the voltage on its base. And it's set such a way that the voltage on the base is just below the threshold where this transistor starts conducting, coupled directly with no capacitor into this transistor, the last stage of the amplifier, and this goes into this voltage-controlled oscillator. It's just a very simple 555 oscillator with a speaker or piezo buzzer. And it's more or less a normal oscillator with a 555 oscillator chip, but instead of connecting this resistor to the positive, it's going to this transistor. So it can basically modulate the frequency. The more current goes into the circuit through this transistor, the faster it oscillates. And it's basically a constant on time, but a variable of time. And of course the oscillator also doubles up as a pulse width modulation of this LED. And it has this pull-down resistor here, which gives it some kind of threshold, so it doesn't start oscillating at a very low current, so it doesn't make occasional clicks. So it goes basically from silence straight into several hertz clicking. The lower this resistor, the sharper the threshold between the silence and this oscillator oscillating. And this potentiometer is shifting the threshold up or down. And of course you have to choose this capacitor for the resonant frequency to be the same as in the transmitter, and somebody in the comments said I should use a variable capacitor. But of course the problem is that you don't get variable capacitors of such a high capacitance. Variable capacitors usually go to about 500 picofarads. And the capacitance you need here is about almost 3 orders of magnitude higher. So you have to basically experiment with different capacitors. I ended up using 250 nano here and I basically put a 220 nano and then I started adding 10 nano capacitors in parallel. I put 220 nano and when adding another 10 nano, the amplitude went up. So I knew that I actually need more than 220 nano and I was adding 10 nano capacitors until the amplitude went back down. And then of course I went back to one capacitor less. The steady state voltage on the collector here is about 2 volts with this circuitry disconnected. And those amplifiers have about 2.5 volts on the collectors in a steady state. And of course you can set the frequency response by changing those capacitors, those coupling capacitors and this band pass filter capacitor. And of course if those capacitors are too low capacitance, then the coupling works only for higher frequencies and so you have to swipe the coil fast and it doesn't work when you swipe slowly. But of course it's capacitively coupled, not DC coupled, so it can automatically set itself. It's super sensitive and so it's almost impossible to manually set the operating point of those amplifiers. So when it's capacitively coupled, it's automatically setting itself and automatically compensating for a background signal. So it's basically detecting just sudden changes of the signal strength. It does not indicate any slow drift of the signal, which might be a temperature drift or battery voltage drift as the battery discharges. But of course, if the capacitors are too high capacitance on the other hand, then it may take a long time before it all settles. And of course, if this demodulation capacitor is too high capacitance, the responses are too slow and it works poorly when you swipe too fast. And the same applies to this capacitor. If it's too high capacitance, the responses are slow and the sensitivity goes down when you swipe too fast. And I added some diodes in the bases of the transistors to protect it against the too high negative voltage if the amplifier is overdriven, if you put some big metal object too close to it. And this demodulation capacitor has a discharging resistor and of course if the resistance is too high, it's discharging it too slowly and the responses are too slow. But on the other hand, if it's too low resistance, it's discharging it too fast and you may get more high frequency ripple remaining here. And also if the responses are too fast, it may pick up some interferences. Of course it only makes sense to pick up changes or signals that are slow enough to be generated by a mechanical motion. Anything that's too fast to be generated by a mechanical motion of the coil is better to be filtered out. But also very slow signals are filtered out, so it filters out basically, for example, the battery voltage drift, the temperature drift of various components and it accommodates for the steady state level of the signal. It only responds to its changes. Ideally just changes that are not too slow, not too fast. Basically the signal strength changes, happening at speeds that can be generated by the motion of the coil above the terrain. So of course the values of this capacitor, this resistor, this capacitor and this capacitor and this one are a lot of trial and error. And I added some additional interference filter for the first stage using this resistor and capacitor, but it might not be necessary. I tried to bypass this resistor and it worked basically the same. And of course the strength of the signal modulates the frequency of the buzzer. So you can tell roughly the size of the object or the distance from it by the pitch of the sound. And of course this is way better than using a self-oscillating buzzer like in this one, which is just on or off. And of course the maximum frequency is given by those components in the oscillator. Those resistors set the frequency when this transistor is fully on. When it's not fully on, it's limiting the current in the oscillator and reduces the frequency. And now I'm powering it using 4.8 volts from 4 nickel metal hydride or nickel cadmium cells and it doesn't seem to be a problem. The voltage decline of the battery as it discharges doesn't seem to be a problem. The entire circuitry can basically work with a certain range of voltages. And of course the amplitude of the transmitter declines with the voltage, but this circuitry only amplifies the changes of the signal strength, the sudden ones. So it seems that it doesn't need a voltage regulator. Of course if it was necessary I could use a 7805 regulator and about 6 nickel metal hydride or nickel cadmium cells in series instead of 4. Or some rechargeable 9-volt battery to power the input of the 7805 regulator. But so far it seems to run on an unregulated voltage straight from the battery pack. And the only thing sensitive to the voltage drift could be this resistive divider setting the voltage on the base of this transistor. But of course, on my batteries, it can run for about 20 or 30 hours, so the voltage drift is so slow that it's not a problem. You basically reset this potentiometer maybe once every couple hours of operation. But to make it even more stable, it would be possible to power this voltage divider from a simple voltage regulator based on a Zener diode. And I sticky taped the coils to this bathroom tile, an absolutely random object I came across. But it still seems to be sensitive to vibrations. It picks up the vibrations from the floor, for example when a truck drives around. Even me moving on the floor slightly makes it indicate. So the next step definitely is to put this in resin. And of course here sits in my prototyping board. Here's the transmitter, with the big capacitor at the input, the inductor, the transformer, the pair of transistors, their resistors in the bases, and this resonant capacitor. And here's the receiver with the resonant capacitors for the coil, the limiting diodes here, the first amplifying transistor for the high frequency. Here's the demodulating transistor, connected as an emitter follower. Then the first low frequency amplifier transistor. And of course before this one there is this demodulation capacitor and its discharging resistor and some interference filter capacitor. And after the first amplifier stage there is the second one with the transistor. And then the rest of it is still in this breadboard. The third stage of the low frequency amplifier and the fourth stage, the last transistor before it goes into this 555 oscillator and this beeper and this LED. And I also tried to actually put one turn on the transformer here and actually put it into this potentiometer and try to fine tune it using a potentiometer. Balance it using a potentiometer instead of moving the coils. And it kind of works. A small voltage comes from the transformer and you can set it using a potentiometer and add it to the voltage from the receiver coil to basically fine balance it with the transmitter coil. You can increase the voltage in one direction or in the other you can increase the voltage 180 degrees shifted. So that's how to fine balance it using a potentiometer. Instead of moving the coils and changing how much they overlap. And I was tuning the coils to get the minimum voltage amplitude at the output of the high frequency amplifier. And of course the voltage from the receiver coil is small, so I measure it after the amplifier and you have a certain minimum point and the voltage goes up when you go to more overlapping coils and also when you go to less overlapping coils. I was always tuning it for this minimum point. But then I noticed that it actually might be more sensitive to the metal objects when it's not tuned to the minimum but somewhere slightly in the direction of less overlapping coils. I'm getting more sensitivity when I tune it here, less overlapping coils. And it kind of makes sense because when you put the metal object to it, you're kind of moving the voltage on this curve, and at the minimum point it's kind of moving almost horizontally, and it doesn't change the voltage much. But when you get to this slope, it's already changing the voltage more significantly. But if I tune it to this point, it's actually indicating when the metal object is getting farther from the coil. So it's better to tune it here, where it's indicating when it's getting closer. And now the power consumption is lower thanks to the thicker wire of the transmitter coil and a better resonant capacitor in the transmitter. And now it seems to draw only 70 milliamps from my 4 nickel metal hydride cells in series. And it doesn't seem to be necessary to regulate the voltage and the output voltage of a 4-cell nickel cadmium or nickel metal hydride battery pack is about 5 volts for most of the discharge. It doesn't really change that much. In single-use alkaline batteries, the voltage declines much faster and it changes much more during the discharge. But of course it's also possible to power it from some USB power bank. And I'm trying to use just one turn instead of the entire coil to tune it. Because otherwise it's super extremely sensitive. By moving just one turn, you can do a little better fine adjustment. And of course you can increase the sensitivity of it by adding more turns on the receiver coil, but there is a certain maximum output voltage swing of the high frequency amplifier. But of course the amplifier doesn't have a hard clipping, it's more like a soft clipping. And of course as you keep increasing the number of turns of the receiver coil, the voltage is getting higher and higher. Until basically the voltage even in the minimum point hits the limit of the amplifier. And the amplifier will be constantly overdriven. Even if you balance it as good as you can, you still have some voltage at the output of the coil and if you have too many turns, the output voltage is too high, even at the minimum point. So you have to choose some reasonable number of turns, so it's not going to overdrive the amplifier and the curve of the voltage at the output is probably something like this, and I guess you get the most sensitivity when you tune it to the steepest point of the curve. And why it's impossible to completely cancel out the voltage? I think it's because the signal comes to the receiver coil with different phase shifts. Some of the signal comes from the transmitter coil directly, but it also comes from various objects with some phase shift and also maybe capacitively coupled to it. By moving the coils, you can't cancel out the phase shifted signals. And also the circuitry with the potentiometer couldn't cancel it out. And I haven't tested it yet, but I was thinking about something like this. To basically use quadrature signals for the compensation. You could add some signal from the transformer using this, a potentiometer connected to just a resistive divider, but also another potentiometer connected to a phase shifter, with a 90 degree shifted signal. And theoretically, by the combination of those two potentiometers, you could perfectly cancel out any signal, which is sine wave. Now testing it and it seems to do something. I can actually turn the potentiometers, one and the other, and cancel it out mostly, except something that's not a sine wave. And of course the potentiometers are changing not only the amplitude of it, but also the phase shift of it. And those sudden changes of the level are probably the zero crossings of the oscillator, when basically the transistors switch, one turns off and the other turns on. So it's possible to cancel it out, except those non-sine wave things on it. And a side note, an iron coin can actually delay the waveform, or also advance it based on its position. When the coin is horizontal, it seems to advance the waveform. When it's vertical, it retards it. Horizontal, vertical. So it seems that this contraption can cancel out the waveform in the receiver coil quite nicely. And of course you may need more turns than one on the transformer. Now I have two turns on it. But of course the question is it actually good to cancel it out as much as possible? It seems that it's not. It's actually better to leave some voltage on the coil and operate it basically at a slope instead of at the minimum point. But of course it brings another question. What phase shift should the remaining voltage on the receiver coil have? And is the improvement even worth building this crazy circuit? To find out, it would require a lot of experimentation. But before I do this, I would have to put the coils in resin because it's so sensitive to vibrations that it's not easy to do those experiments. But let's leave the further experimentation for the next episode. But otherwise it's quite promising so far, and it can detect this coin from about 35 centimeters. And a small iron can from about 70 or 80 centimeters, which is quite impressive for such a small coil. This is Derek Wild, and see you in my next videos, and thanks to all of my patrons on Patreon. I really appreciate your support. And of course you can also become my patron to support my channel and get early videos. The link to my Patreon is in the description, as well as the link to my Instagram. And of course in the next episode, putting the coil in resin. I have to get some resin, I haven't used any resin before.